Today I've got 7 things I bet you didn't know about HTML. Hey, I'm Mark Lassoff. Welcome to the channel. I've got a really cool video for you today. I'm gonna show you 7 really neat tricks with HTML. I didn't even know about some of these. I really think you're gonna enjoy them and they're gonna make you a better HTML coder. Hey, by the way, if you like this kind of video, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. I come out with new videos a couple of times a week showing you how to become a professional level developer and digital designer. With that, let's get started with trick number one. Trick number one, progress bar. Notice as I click the add value button here, the progress bar is filling towards the right. The way that I coded this is with the progress tag on line 12. Notice the progress tag has a couple of attributes. The first is the initial value. Max is the maximum value. So this particular progress bar, when we refresh, is starting at a value of 31 and goes to a maximum value of 100. If I set value to 0 and then saved and refreshed our document, notice now it starts at 0 and we add value. Now, of course, the actual progression of the progress bar is being coded with JavaScript. So you do need a little bit of JavaScript to make this progress bar work. Let's take a look. So notice my script starts on line 15. On line 16, we have document get element by ID button add value. That's the button that I've been pressing to progress the progress bar towards the right. On that button, we're adding an event listener, listening for a click event, meaning that the function that starts to the right of click is going to fire each time I press the button. All that function does is it gets the progress bar, document get element by ID prog bar, and adds 2 to the current value. So you notice as I click each time, it's adding 2. If I set this to 1, saved and refreshed in my browser, now each time I click, we're simply adding 1 to the value of the progress bar. Trick number 2, editable text. Did you know you can make any HTML element editable? Let me show you how. So see where it says this text is editable? I can go in here and I can change the text. This text has been edited. Now the text below it is not editable. We do this with a simple attribute. Notice line 18 of the code has the content editable attribute. Any place we use the content editable attribute, the text inside is going to be editable. So, for example, in the paragraph tag on line 19, if I add the content editable attribute, we don't have to set that to any value, and save and refresh, now both of these elements are editable. In fact, I could take all this text and press delete and simply add HTML is fun. Trick number 3, use the picture element for more responsive images in your websites. Notice on line 12 of my code, I have an element named picture. It ends on line 16. This is actually one I didn't know about before, and now that I've discovered it, I'm gonna use it a lot. Inside the picture element, you have 3 other elements. The first 2 are source elements. Notice that the source elements point to a source set attribute, which has a large image.jpg and a small image.jpg in the second one. These are designed to display different images at different screen widths. So on line 13, we have a source with a media query for a minimum width of 968 pixels. If the minimum width is 968 pixels, then the large image JPEG is gonna load. On line 14, we have a source with a media query for a minimum width of 360 pixels. So with a minimum width of 360 pixels up to 968 pixels, small image.jpg is gonna load. And then for browsers that don't support the picture element, we have a default image on line 15. This allows us to select different images optimized for different screen sizes. Pretty cool. Trick number 4, text input with suggestions. So check out this text input I've got here. It acts kind of like a dropdown and kind of like a text input. So if I start typing here, it's actually going to eliminate possibilities, and I can select with my arrow keys. Or I can type something that's totally not here, like that. So this is a kind of cool input if you have a limited range of suggestions that you want to provide to the user. Let's take a look at the code and see how it works. On line 17, we have our input tag, and notice we have a list attribute set to the value countries. And then surrounding all of our options, we have a data list element. Notice the data list element starts on 18 and ends all the way down on line 260. And inside there, we have all of our country options that are part of our data list. These are actually all of the suggestions. So if you take a look carefully, the first suggestion is United States. We have a value attribute, if this particular option is selected, and then we have the text display. So it's actually taking these options and displaying them as a data list with autocomplete. So one more time, as I start to type, it eliminates possibilities until there's just one or two possibilities left. So this is really, really cool and can save your user some time and also make sure that you get better, cleaner data because your user's less likely to make mistakes when you use this trick. Trick number five, highlighting text. This is an easy one. Notice the text on the first line here has been highlighted. The way I did that is I used a span and gave it a class highlight. That span just spans the first sentence inside this paragraph. If we look at the styles on line 10, I then created a class for highlight and simply set the background color to that text on yellow, so it appears like a highlighter. Trick six, drop-down action groups. Sometimes when you have a drop-down, you need to organize the different options under headers. Here's how you do it. So notice when I click this drop-down, we've got action options, animation options, and horror options. And the headers aren't themselves selectable, but underneath them, text like The Karate Kid is. If we take a closer look at our select element, you'll notice we have options and option groups. So the first option group is labeled action. And in there, I've got the values Avengers, Die Hard, Fast and Furious, The Dark Knight, and The Karate Kid. Action is grayed out, and that's because that is the value of the label attribute on line 20. The next option group works the same way. We have a label animation, and then under it, the values Despicable Me, Ice Age, Kung Fu Panda, etc. The final label is horror, so I use a final option group with the label horror. Notice your option groups have to both open and close and have the included options inside of the opt group tag. So now you can better organize different options in a dropdown. This is trick seven, limiting input with regular expressions. Let's take a look at this create a username input box. It requires 4 to 10 characters. So let's say I type 3 characters. Like Bob. I click go. Notice it's rejected that input. Please match the requested format. Let's type too many characters. The Karate Kid. Go. Please match the requested format. However, if I provide between 4 and 10 characters, it accepts the values. Now, by the way, this also only accepts letters and not numbers. So if I type A1 steak, it rejects that. But if I get rid of the 1 and remove the space, it accepts that value. So we did this with a technology called regular expressions. Regular expressions is a pattern matching technology that lets you match patterns in characters. If you haven't heard of regular expressions, this is how it knows if your email's in the right format. It's looking for the at sign and the dot, for example. Counts how many characters you have in a set of text. So I'm not going to explain all of regular expressions here. Believe it or not, that could be an entire course. but you can look up a lot of regular expressions to match patterns like phone numbers or zip codes or email addresses. So for this example, I just looked up a regular expression to give me between 4 and 10 characters, only letters. Let's see how we implement it. So we have our form, and the relevant part of the form is the input on line 14. We have our typical attributes, type, name, and ID. Then we have our placeholder, which has 4 to 10 characters, and then we have our pattern. And inside the pattern, in the quotes, is the regular expression. So the range of characters we're allowing is A to Z capital or A to Z lowercase, no numerals. The second part of that regular expression means it needs to be between 4 and 10 characters. And that's what's limiting our actual input. So this would not be returned to the action of the form or whatever's processing the form until we met the requirements of that pattern in that attribute on line 14. We also gave this autofocus, so this particular field is focused on automatically, and made it required. So it had to be filled out in order for the form to be submitted. But the real trick here is pattern matching. And you can put any regular expression in there and match the pattern. Pretty cool. And that takes care of my 7 HTML tricks that I bet you weren't aware of. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video and got something out of it. My name is Mark Lassoff. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And also please check out our website where I run the only $9.95 a month coding bootcamp that teaches you professional development skills and helps you get your first job in industry. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.